I will never work for money.
Action Crane!
I will work only on things that I have complete control of. I feel when I make a film, if I put my name on it, then I'm responsible for it, for the good and the bad, the mistakes and everything. I think my approach to filmmaking is not to copy. I like to pretend I'm original, which is a lie, and it's me fooling myself, but it gets me through the day when I'm working. Paintings are important to me because I look at things, and there's images that I just want to somehow capture on film. I mean, obviously, I copied, as best one could, Botticelli's Venus in Munchausen, but if you actually look at it, it doesn't look that much like the Venus, except there's a naked girl in the middle on a clamshell.
Hello.
And it's that approach. Every film I make, there's usually an artist that I have in mind. And I suppose my films, I wouldn't say they're necessarily Baroque, but they probably are. They're cluttered. Let's put it that way. There's a lot of stuff to look at in them. And it's partly coming from me wanting to be God. I've always wanted it, but the job was taken by somebody else before I got there.
I am Vulcan, the God.
So within my little world of the films I make, I can play God and I can put all the bits and pieces in that I'm interested in and see what happens to them. So detail is very important. The details make the world to me real because I guess I'm trying to get the audience to believe in the world I'm creating. And it's usually full of mistakes and clutter and mess and dirt besides the very beautiful things. I've always felt making films, it's a very fascistic way of working. It's very hierarchical. And I, in my anarchic way, I try to break that down always. I'm hoping this collection of my films will draw attention to the fact I'm still trying to do The Man Who Killed Don Quixote, a film I began in 89 and have spent far too much of my life trying to do. The closest we got was with Johnny Depp and Jean Rochefort in 2000.
It's going to be beautiful. Terrible at the same time.
Yeah. Actually, God was, I think, punishing me for hubris. Everything that could go wrong did go wrong. Literally, it was biblical. We had two young filmmakers who I'd agreed to have them do a documentary, and they were there recording as the shit hit the fan.
Come. What's going on?
And as the weather came in, as everything went wrong, and they've ended up making Lost in La Mancha, which is very interesting because they were trying to make a film about the making of the film. And I said, but you've got a better film here. You've got a film about the not making of a film.
I don't know what else to do. I mean, all of us have done a lot of stuff, and none of us know the answer right now. I mean, you're sitting, everybody is just like...
Disaster is always more interesting than success. I remember when I made Fisher King. What is great about Robin's character, he becomes a fantasist through pain, through anguish, through the fact that his wife was murdered in front of him. And so it's not a happy kind of, oh, isn't this fun? We can all just be kids. There's a price to pay. And I suppose that's true in most of my films. You want somebody who has to deal with the world. We all have to deal with the world. And for those who have been damaged in particular ways, that affects the way they do it. And Robin ends up being a character who is just obsessed about being a knight. And he sees the world through that.
I'm a knight on a special quest, and I need help.
When I set out to shoot the film, the script didn't have some of that element in there, the view of the world. And I thought, this is a kind of fairy tale. So we want to see it, in a sense, through Robin's character. The waltz scene is really quite extraordinary because we had Grand Central Station from 11 o'clock till 5 in the morning for one night only. And we needed 1,000 people to dance. All the extras that came in were supposed to have come from dance schools. They knew how to dance well in whatever style we needed. And when they did the first rehearsal, we realized that these people didn't know how to dance. Half of them did not know how to waltz. And so we have to stop the way we're going to shoot it. And we set up with the choreographers breaking these groups into 300 each and setting up a dance school in Grand Central Station that went on till 3 o'clock in the morning, getting them dancing. And we've got to be out there at 5. And the assistant director saying, oh, they need more time. I said, come on, there's no time now. We just have to shoot. Whatever we're going to do, we're shooting right now. And we did. And that's what you see on film. We got it. And what was interesting is that at the morning, we were supposed to be out of there at 5 because trains start turning up at 5:30. And we weren't. We were still there. Commuters were arriving. And we still had to get shots of Robin in the mix looking lost after Lydia disappears. And it ends up with shots of Robin amongst real commuters pouring past him with as much of the crew that we had mixing in to keep it all moving. I've always believed that children and fools have the better view of the world. That's what intrigues me, to have that kind of innocence, which a madman has in his own way as well, to see through all of the noise that we make around ourselves. We do these things to say, this is what is reality. And it's just not. It's a reality. It's not all of the realities that are available out there. I don't know if I believe in alternate universes, but I do believe in very different views of the world, if you can learn to look at the world in these different ways. Kevin, the main character in Time Bandits, is really a product of me wanting to make a film through a child's eyes. My initial feeling was I need a kid who will be the main character in the film, and my concern about that, I then felt I better surround him with a gang of other actors who can help carry him through it, and they became the same height as him, so they became little people.
Hang on, he's just a kid.
He knows an awful lot, Randall.
Yeah, and he's bigger than any of us.
My idea at the heart of it is to make people see the world in a different way, to think differently.
How about you?
They don't have to see the world the way I see it. I want them to see the world they are capable of seeing. And I keep trying to bring back a kind of childlike view of the world, where you're innocent, where you're surprised, as a child is. I reject the limitations that the media puts on the world. So I'm trying to open up doors and windows that people can say, oh, God, yes, I never thought of it like that, or I never saw it like that. Films can change the world. Bringing back love and romance and magic are the job I try to do.
It wasn't just a story, was it?
For FilmStruck, I'm Terry Gilliam.